It's a pleasure to have Preben Bjerregaard with us today. I hope I'm pronouncing the name correctly, because it came all the way from Denmark. So Preben received all of his medical training in Denmark before coming to this country. I noticed that there was some surgery involved in the training. And he came to this country, but on the way stopped for 6 months, I believe, in Baghdad, Iraq, where he worked as a cardiology consultant, and his wife worked as a nurse.
No, she didn't.
Oh, I thought she did. Okay, and then he came to this country, and Preben actually moved, was in Oklahoma City for a while, and came to St. Louis, where he joined St. Louis University and was on the faculty there until 2010, where he moved and changed his affiliation to Washington University, where he's a professor of medicine, internal medicine in the cardiovascular division. He also heads the cardiac electrophysiology section at the VA. Preben is a pioneer in this whole area of the short QT syndrome. I think all of you heard and know heard a lot about the long QT syndrome. Preben basically discovered and defined the other end, the short QT syndrome, and he will tell us about this today. So thank you for coming to present to us.
I'm glad to be here. I'm gonna try to tell you how it all went from a single patient with a single EKG to a syndrome that's known all over the world, and there are patients all over the world. Even though there are special centers, special places where they mainly are interested in this syndrome, because it gained a lot of interest to begin with, because as you know, long QT syndrome has been known since 1957, and it's a well-known syndrome, as I'm sure going to show you some numbers also, but rather common. And the peculiar phenomenon is that no one up to this point had thought about the possibility that a short QT could be arrhythmogenic and cause the same problem as long QT. So that in itself obviously created a lot of interest. And just to give you a little idea of what the difference is, I just taken three EKGs here at 100, approximately 60 beats per minute, and shown what a normal QT interval looks like. It's even a QT a little to the short side of normal. What it looks like when it's very long, long QT. And then there's really incredibly short QT in the short QT syndrome. The normal range for QT is somewhere between 360 and 450 milliseconds. And if we briefly look at what has happened over the last 12 years since it was discovered, pretty much every aspect of that disease has been described, maybe not in full detail. I'm sure there's still things that need to be done, but looking at what we know about long QT, a lot of it has been described now for the short QT. It was in 1999 that I met the first family with that syndrome. And a year later, we published a paper describing it based upon my family here, three family members, and an isolated case from Spain, Europe. We didn't know at that time that it was significant in terms of ventricular arrhythmias and sudden deaths, because my family really only had atrial fibrillation. But it was kind of peculiar that the long QT would give atrial arrhythmias. idea that it probably would be significant also in terms of ventricular arrhythmias. But in 2003, as I'm going to show you, there were two families from Europe presented with a very high incidence of short QT, of sudden cardiac death in that family. And that's why immediately after treatment with defibrillators was initiated. Already in 2004, I mean, just 4 years after the first family was described, the first mutation was found. Pharmacologic treatment was considered and tried, but obviously in the few, very low number of patients, it's very difficult to assess the significance of the effect of treatment, but some, we have learned some over the last few years. There was an experimental model by Selovich that was published, and in 2005, we wrote the first review article, which was kind of, it was only on 22 patients. I guess the reason we felt we could do that was that these 22 patients really were very much alike. It was sort of, felt at that time that we already knew quite a bit, even though we only had these 22 patients. The first patient was saved by a defibrillator. Interesting, it was a 15-year-old young man who had never had any symptoms and only got the defibrillator because he had somewhat of a short QT and there were some episodes of sudden death in his family. So based on that, they gave him a defibrillator in one night. He had ventricular fibrillation and was saved by the defibrillator. The same year, a category of short QT, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about, was detected. That was unique by the fact that it presented itself as a very slow pulse in the fetus. The first time you could get a pulse on this baby, the heart rate was only around 50 beats per minute. That's the way the child was born. We came up with a website in 2005, that was the time when people started to think about how common is these very short QT intervals. Because obviously we had these few patients with this very short QT, and we really didn't know at that point how unique this was. Was that something that pretty common, so I'll show you some numbers for that. 2007, it was shown that there are some Lugada patients that has very short QT. A mutation was linked to sudden infant death syndrome. The prognostic significance of a short QT interval was also reported, and the first animal model was interestingly enough in a zebra fish that has short QT syndrome. And then the next thing that happened was that people start to think about what about drugs that shorten the QT? Because you know when you have to have drugs approved, they have to go through very rigorous testing to make sure they don't prolong the QT. But all of a sudden they had to think about also the other end of the spectrum. What about drugs that has potential of shortening QT? And then here, this year, someone came out with proposed some diagnostic criteria, which I don't think are that useful yet. And the first study, they called it long-term follow-up, but it was only a six-year follow-up of 53 patients. So this is sort of a brief summary of history of short QT syndrome. Just to put it in perspective, the long QT syndrome is kind of interesting because long QT syndrome was discovered by Jagerlund and Nilsson in 1957. And in the first 12 years, they found 25 additional cases. If you look at short QT, it was discovered in 2000. In the first 12 years, we have 100 cases. So based on that, we still don't know for sure where we're going to end up with short QT because we have only had a brief period of time to look at these data. I don't believe myself that it's going to be as common as longevity, but it's still interesting. So the prevalence of long QT is somewhere between 1 in 2 or 5,000. What it is in short QT, we obviously don't know at this point. And this was the first patient. he came to me after he had abdominal surgery. He developed AFib, atrial fibrillation, and she was only 17 years old, so that was kind of peculiar. And when she came to me, this was her EKG. I want you to pay attention to the fact that all the EKGs you see are 25 millimeters per second. That's going to be important later on, about some problems we had getting it published. And as you can see here, QT is very short. And it was especially evident after we cardioverted her, and you see this, these very, very, very short, you have 230 milliseconds, whereas you recall that low limit for normal is around 350 milliseconds. So 230 milliseconds obviously was something very unique, very extraordinary. This was, then next time she came to my clinic, that's when it all sort of changed, because she came with her brother and her mother, and somehow I got the idea that maybe it's something that's in her family, and it turned out to be. But as you can see here, the brother has QT interval that's just as short, 245 milliseconds. And he had something also that's been reported, some very rather tall and peak T waves reported lead. The mother was the same, 235 milliseconds. The father had a normal EKG, normal QT. And these were the three that was published first, but later on we found that the maternal grandfather actually had the short QT, came from Italy and brought in the mutation to this country. You can see very, very short QT. Then we're going to publish this, but we didn't think we had a whole lot. We had some atrial fibrillation, we had three people with short QT. But what happened next was that Joseph Bugada from Spain had an EKG laying on his desk for 2 years with a very short QT. We happened to talk to him and explain what we had found. And this was a very peculiar case also, because he was called on a Friday that there was a girl who had had frequent single episodes. They wanted him to see her. And he said, I can see her Monday morning, but she died over the weekend suddenly. And when he got her EKG, this is what he saw, this very short QT. And this was all he had, so he obviously didn't have enough to really go anywhere. We didn't know what was the significance, or whether it was related. But we decided to publish it together. And how about sending it to circulation? We thought we had something good, something new, something that everybody would be interested in. But we were very disappointed, because they didn't believe us. They didn't think that a QT could be that short. So they rejected the manuscript. As you can see, they didn't find acceptable for publication. And they say one wonders about error of the paper speed. That's why, as I pointed out, obviously if you run this paper a little slower, your O'Connor, we had a very short QT. But they wanted to see the original EKGs, and we sent them the original EKGs, and they still didn't believe us. And that's why it was not published in circulation. But because it published, this was actually the EKGs we sent to circulation. They didn't believe it. They said, these QRS companies are too narrow. There's some problem here and there. The only problem I can see is a little artifact here. Otherwise, the EKG is pretty neat. So we published our data in Cardiology, a European journal, after having had talks with some of our colleagues. And before we started out with myself, and then before we knew it, we were a lot of people on this paper. But that's okay. An interesting thing is that this girl who came to my, now had a baby, and as you can see, this baby has exactly the same problem. I obviously had told her there was a 50% risk that this might happen, and it did happen. And this is where we stand with a lot of these patients today, is these children that are born with this very short QT, because it's very difficult to put a defibrillator into a newborn. And we don't really know of any other way to really protect these patients. So this is the first paper then that describes this very high risk of sudden cardiac death. There was two families, an Italian and a German family, and if you've seen this Italian family, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 episodes of sudden cardiac death in that family. So it became all of a sudden apparent that this was a very risky thing to have such a short QT. There's a German family where there were 3 episodes of sudden cardiac death. Now I'm going to talk about something that I knew you were going to be interested in. I have to confess that I don't know a whole lot about cellular electrophysiology, so I cannot take any questions, but I can show you what I've got here. This was the first mutation discovered by Ramon Bugada in Charles Anselovich's lab, and it was the first two families, the Italian and the German family. They all had the same genetic mutation in the HERG gene, and it was the same mutation that we later found out that my family had. So the first 3 families all had the same genetic mutation. And this is what it looks like today. So a lot have changed since then. We almost have a similar number of mutations, at least a similar number of genes as long QT syndrome. So the first that was discovered was this N588K in the HERG gene. And now there are 5 families with that, and the number is somewhere around 12. And if you look at the index patients that's been tested, the mutation has today been found in 23%. I have to go back again here. On the top you have the KCNH2, the KCNQ1, and KCNPA2, these 3 potassium channels. They are the ones that, up till today, are most related to short QT syndrome, because they only give short QT. There are some other genes, some other mutations, in especially the calcium channels, they can give a somewhat short QT in addition to ST segment changes that looks like Bugada syndrome. So these are more kind of an overlap syndromes here, where you have somewhat of a short QT, but you also have ST changes that look like Bugada syndrome. And that's where, if we see the next slide here, you can see this is a patient that has short QT, and if you see in V1, V2, usually where you look for the Bugada sign, there is a little gay wave here, but as soon as you give this patient isoleucine or a sodium channel blocker, you get the more typical very prominent J wave, descending ST segment, negative Q wave, the typical type 1 Bugatta pattern. But if you go back to the KCNH2 gene mutation, and we call these patients now short 2T1, because this was the mutation that was found first, and so just a phonologic sequence, so they're called short 2T1, 2, and 3. The short 2T1 is patients who have the KCNH2 mutation, and I have to write this down so I don't make any mistake here, but obviously what you find is a gain of function in these mutations, and in the KCNH2 obviously it increases the IKR. And what it leads to is this positive shift in voltage dependence of inactivation, so you get inactivation much later than you otherwise would, and that is what leads to the increased large increase in current. And here's a figure from Bugatta's paper, I'm sure you're all familiar with, where you typically can see here the normal channel with normal rectification, and the other one that just keeps it generating current. MacPate's group looked at the effect, just quantitative a little bit more, in cells at 37 degrees, and demonstrated that the positive shift was approximately 60 millivolts. MacPate's name you'll see here several times. It's a lab in Bristol, where they have done really most of the work related to short QT syndrome. They also looked at the heteromeric current, where you have the two different Hertz channels, Hertz 1A and Hertz 1B. I'm not too familiar with that, but apparently these two are often together, that there's not just one Hertz, but there are two different. And if they looked at that, they got even more amazing results in terms of the high current of that mutation. They also looked at the effect on A12 action potential and showed that the effect there is sort of the same, just not as pronounced as in the ventricle. And finally, there are some that shown that it may be a mixed gain and loss of function from that mutation, where the loss of function is reduced, the tail current, maybe some slower activation, faster deactivation. And that is a group from Denmark, Grunert and his colleague, who have shown this tremendous effect of that mutation. Here again, the normal, here again, the mutation. And here where you have KCNE2 mixed. Here's the tail current, the normal tail current, and here is reduced tail current here, so probably also some also is an effect of this mutation. And finally, at the bottom here, one thing that was very peculiar was very early observed by Bugatta and his group that antiarrhythmic drugs really does not work on these patients the same way it does on normal, that the mutation affects the how these antiarrhythmics work. And MacPate again has sort of quantitated the decrease in potency of these antiarrhythmic drugs in patients with the HERC mutation, and found that clazosin probably is the one that's affected the least. Decrease in potency is 1.5. Clopidogrel next, and quinidine, and then amiodarone. So there is a lack of effect on these channels by these antiarrhythmic drugs. Not to a point where they don't work, but certainly you have to give more to obtain benefit. Quinidine is a drug that's been tested most, especially in patients with a HERT mutation. It's difficult to tell what to aim at. What they have been doing in Europe is giving quinidine till you normalize the QT. That may be a good way of doing it, but whether that really lowers the risk of arrhythmia is not known up to this point. The next gene was the KCNQ1 that was discovered in Europe. There's a lab in Nantes, Franks, and Arthur Wilder from Utrecht that together discovered this in a 70-year-old male. So if you look here, these are the KCNH2 gene mutation here. These are the KCNQ1 mutations. And this one, the V307L, was found in a 70-year-old gentleman with a very short QT who had cardiac arrest. And here's what you can see. What's typical for this mutation is also, again, the gain of function. What you see is a faster activation than in the wild type cells. And again, it's been tested and it's 37 degrees and it's been shown that there is a marked about minus 67 millivolt shift in half maximal activation for this mutation compared to the wild type. So obviously the net effect is an earlier and much larger current from that mutation. And also here they have demonstrated the same effect in the atrium. One thing here that I want to spend a couple of minutes on is this particular mutation here, the V141M, because this is the mutation that leads to this special unique syndrome where babies are born with a pulse in the 40s or 50s and they have atrial fibrillation with a very slow heart rate. And if you look at this, what it does down here compared to the wild type, again, it's an enormous increase in current. As you can see, they have this current for this mutation developed instantaneous at voltages, all voltages tested, and gives this very enormous current compared to the wild type, the normal. What they also did was some computer models that I don't know anything about, but I think I will have Joran to look at these and maybe see if he can make something similar, find out what's going on, because one of the interesting thing is the fact that the sinus node does not seem to work in these patients. And one thing they showed is you can see that the normal, you have the normal sort of change in voltage that leads to sinus node output and sinus rhythm, whereas in the mutated channel you didn't see any oscillations whatsoever. And they looked at the IKS and the funny channel here in the atrium. So if you can see for the mutations, there was no effect whatsoever, whereas there was some oscillation, some effect, obviously, in the normal cells. I don't know how much that proves, except it probably suggests that what we also know clinically, that there is some significant problems in the sinus node in these children along with a short QT.
So these children had their IKS channels constitutively all
Right.
And they survive?
And they survive.
They survive.
Yeah. 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 It's sort of unique in a way, the way they were able to survive such a slow pulse. So here is the EKG from this 12 days old baby. See, it's irregular, you cannot see any atrial activity. And that was one of the things, it's interesting, these babies have been found in five different countries, and every time they have not been able to tell what kind of rhythm it was, so they have all had intra-atrial recordings to confirm the atrial fibrillation. But it just looked like a kind of slow irregular rhythm, but you cannot tell anything about the atrium until you put a catheter in the atrium, and then you can see that it's actually atrial fibrillation. I don't think I need to go through the whole clinical scenario with this child. This is a child I follow in Michigan, and this child was born with this heart rate of 55, and due to interval only 260 milliseconds. Cardioversion was initially unsuccessful, and that she was tried an MU, and cardioversion was successful for a brief moment, and after we could get an EKG with sinus rhythm, so obviously there was still some sinus node function, but again, pretty slow for a baby. And we did Holter monitoring, and this was when the child was 18 months old. You can see this child is most of the time living with a very slow, regular junctional rhythm because of apparently significant block in the AV node. She is doing fine, as the next I'll show you. 18 months old, she was out having skis on it, and actually did fine. And this is what she looked like 4 years old. She's now 6 years old and completely healthy. But it's interesting that I have now six cases like that. They're all completely identical. And I have the 5 year, and I have a number six that also is where the mutation here has been found. So three of these six have documented the same mutation, giving exactly the same picture. As you can see, four here plus the fifth were diagnosed in utero, and they all have this slow heart rate and very short QT interval.
Do you know what happens to their QT interval with, is it a function of heart rate? Does it regulate like normal? Because
no,
that's what I expect. Because the IKS is beta adrenergic regulated,
right?
And if they have it open all the time, then there is nothing to regulate. So
that's right, and that's unique. It's not unique for this group. It's something that's typical for everyone with a short QT interval, that you have very little change in QT interval, the heart rate, and it's one of the I'm going to show a little more later, because it's a very important thing in diagnosing these patients, that correcting the QT interval with facets formed or any other way does not make any sense whatsoever, because there is almost no change in QT interval with heart rate in these people. So here, just to show you an intracardiac recording in two of these patients, can't go into detail with these, but these were EKGs from these four different papers. I think this one here is interesting because it was from 2006 from Leeds in England that they published this child, and they stated that the QT interval is normal. I mean, I think that just tells you that just a few years ago, we were only concerned about prolonged QT, because obviously if you measure this QT interval here with a heart rate that may only be 40, the QT may be certainly less than 300 milliseconds. But they have not measured it, obviously, and contact with them, and it turns out that this child's father, who is in his 30s, has the same EKG, short QT and atrial fibrillation. That is the, finally, the third mutation is short QT3, KZNDA2, which has been described only by Sylvia Priori. It's almost her syndrome. She described the first patient with a D172, and here at the last American Heart meeting, she presented two additional families with KZNDA2 mutation, and mutation in KZNDA2. So it's kind of interesting. I don't know if it's because they only have these families in Turin and in Italy, or it's because you see what you're looking for and you recognize what you know. That's probably what it is. So I would think if other labs would start to look for mutations in this KZNDA2, they might also find it. But she is, up to this point, the only one who has found these mutations. And this is what happened there. If you just look at the bottom here, the bottom here is the normal IV relationship, and here are the mutations. You can see the current obviously is much larger with the mutation, and then peak later. And I think one thing that she showed in a computer simulation is that it increased the output current greatly at the final phase of ribbonization, and it also and then shortened the exponential. But this acceleration at the end of ribbonization, she used to explain why these patients have T waves that has a very steep descent. It's either have the peak T waves that we talked about, some of these patients have, but this final acceleration late during ribbonization, they explain why these T waves have such a steep descent. And it may be the same as we know from Lompuge syndrome, that the morphology of the T waves to some degree can explain what kind of mutation you have behind your syndrome. It's interesting, the one patient she presented at the American Heart had this E299B mutation, and obviously looks totally different. Here rectification is preserved, here is lost. So even though it's mutation with the same gene, the result is totally different. And then briefly, these patients with the short QT and the ST second changes, they were published by Charles and Selovich mainly, and this is again what I showed you before, and here's another figure from his paper that showing three different patients. Again, here you can see the typical Bugatta over here. This patient is somewhat of a Bugatta pattern here. Again, here you can see the current voltage relationship, especially here with the normal here and the loss of function of these calcium channels, and thereby leading to a short QT interval. So while I've been talking here, there's some mutation being added to the list here, and it's kind of interesting. It's one that I really can't talk about because it's not been published yet, but I know about it, and that's why I put it in here, because it gives a very interesting addition to what we know so far. It turns out that in short QT, you almost have problems in the exact same genes as you've had the long QT, just opposite. Where long QT, you have loss of function, you have gain of function, and then opposite with the sodium and calcium channel. So it's very interesting that it turns out that these two diseases are allelic diseases that almost share the same genes where you have problems, and the mutations just make the channel go in two different directions. So this sodium channel here, I can show you if you're not going to tell it to anybody. This is what the EKD looks like with this mutation. I may not agree completely it looks like Bugada, but I think I think what we're looking at is probably a fusion of a J wave and a T wave here in these right recorded leads. And certainly there is a short QT, and this is what it looks like. This channel is almost non-functional. Here's again the normal, and this sodium channel shows very little activity. Well, this was some of the stuff I don't know much about. The clinical picture I'm a lot more familiar with. One problem that we've had up to this point is we've not really been able to define Schottky syndrome very well because of the difficulty in telling exactly where to put the limit for the QT interval, and especially because people continue to use corrected QTC, which you really cannot do in patients with short QT, because the QT almost shows no change in heart rate. This was a definition that, official definition in 2006. I think what's correct about it is that the history of familial sudden death is typical. You have a very short refractive period if you do electrophysiologic studies. And inducible ventricular fibrillation may not be true anymore. The interesting thing with that is you get ventricular fibrillation by putting a catheter in the right ventricle. It's not like you go through programmed stimulation and use VF. What's typical for these patients, just placing your catheter in the right ventricle leads to VF. It is unbelievable how sensitive they are for just a little bit of catheter manipulation. Something you don't see in any other patient. And I think that's one of the things you can use when you want to diagnose that with an EP study, is if you easily induce VF just by sort of moving the catheter. Whereas induction of VF is not shown to be very predictable. This is the map as it looks today. Patient number 100 was just published a couple of weeks ago. And as you can see, it's not a whole lot of patients up to this point. I think for many reasons, not that many know about the syndrome. And again, it's difficult really to make the diagnosis. But as you can see, most of the patients are from Europe. In North America, 25 from the United States, and there's one from Canada. There's one here from Brazil, 7 from China, and 12 from Japan. So this is the whole population of patients published under the diagnosis of short QT syndrome. They present themselves often having had cardiac arrest, or one of the family have had cardiac arrest. Think of the atrial fibrillation, and then the bradycardia at birth. I think without definition of the syndrome, we can at least look at what it looks like to those who have been published. And this is what the QT interval looks like. It's somewhere between 210 and 340. All those who have been published have had a QT in that interval. And the QTC, as you can see, has been between 240 and 345. But there's no doubt that we have have to go a little higher with these QT intervals, that there may be some patients with QT 350. Just think about how difficult it is to measure this QT accurately. We have to look at patients with a little longer QT in order to find all the patients. This is some of the population studies that's been done. It's been interesting where they try to look at how often do we see these very short QT intervals. And you can see it's really not that often. First, the paper that came from Gallagher looked at 12,000 EKGs and found zero with a QTC less than 330. Here's one that looked at 106,000 EKGs, and they only looked at those less than 300 that didn't find any. So you can see they're not that many. It is a Finnish study, and they found a few that had kind of short interval. But overall, without going into detail, you can see there are very few in these rather big population studies of patients with a QTC less than 350. Again, they have not looked at the QT interval, and that could have changed things a little bit. Because if you think about it, the QT does not change with heart rate. And obviously, as the heart rate goes up, the QTC gets higher. And that's why you can easily miss some, because you do a miscalculation, so to speak, when you try to correct for heart rate. So let me just try to make a few statements here about the QT. Maybe I should show the next slide first, because this is a slide that shows the fact that the QT interval varies very little with heart rate. Here you have a patient with short QT syndrome during a stress test and measuring the QT interval as the heart rate goes up. As you can see here, if we look at the heart rate from 60 to 100, there's really not much change, much difference in QT interval here. You take the average there. First, when you get up here, you have a few that looks a little shorter, but that obviously becomes more difficult to measure than accurate. If you compare that to a normal person with a normal QT, obviously the QTR relationship is totally different. So this is a very important point, that within so the normal range of heart rate, there's almost no change in QT. So if you start to correct there, you would overcorrect, so that as the heart rate goes up, the QTC will go up and will give you a very false reading. So this is sort of what I have stated here. And I think it's very important that you cannot define short QT by QTC, because it makes no sense to correct for heart rate. And again, the faster the heart rate, the longer the QTC. And that's why if you want to make a diagnosis of short QT, you should do everything you can to actually get a EKG with a heart rate around 60 beats per minute, instead of trying to correct, because that's very difficult. The lower limit of normal is, again, it's very interesting to look back, because we have many times only defined QT interval by the how long it can be and not by how short it can be. But here are some studies, and you can see the numbers are not really easy to fit under one hat. They vary quite a bit. But I think 360 would probably not be terribly wrong to say a QTC around 360 is probably where the lower limit of normal is. At least for male, female usually have QTs at about 10 milliseconds longer. This is the data from the last latest study, the European, all the European patients I mentioned are being followed by a center in Italy, and they have followed these now for 6 years. And you can see it's in these 6 years there were only two who had BF. They both had defibrillators, so they survived. Those one that had syncope. It's a little mixed group. It's a little difficult to see exactly what's going on here, but age group with hydroquinidine. So what they were doing to some of their patients, they gave them hydroquinidine, and you can see the patients who had quinidine did not have any events. But it doesn't really tell much because the numbers are so small, so it's difficult to make any firm statement. But it looks like that quinidine really have a protective effect. EP studies have also shown that sometimes you've been able to reduce VF off quinidine, and on quinidine you could not do it. So I think these drugs do have play a role, and especially in children where it's very difficult to give them a defibrillator, that some of these drugs will show some protection. There are obviously other places where you can see a short QT interval, and this is a list here where you, besides the short QT in the Brugada syndrome, there are some patients after cardiac arrest, the first EKD you look at may have a short QT because of calcium overloading on the cells. Early liberalization often have shorter than usual QT. Chronic fatigue syndrome is a special form of that, in cardiomyopathy where the QT is short. Digoxin toxicity is well known. And the male hormones is something they use in some of the sports centers to check for athletes using these androgen hormones. If their QT start to get shorter, they know it because they've been taking androgen, they've been taking these hormones. Hypercalcemia, hypothermia, and both atropine and, these atropine can give a short QT. All right. This is a Synthes website if you want to look at more. And this is the post-diagnostic criteria, which I don't think are that useful. There was someone that wanted to imitate Schwartz's criteria for long QT, I think. So you use these criteria and made it into something that probably could use for short QT, but there's not much evidence, much proof behind it that these really are useful. And also, they were using QTC, which you should not do in patients with short QT syndrome. But this is basically the story about this new syndrome, which so far has turned out to be a very rare thing. But as you can imagine from the story about long QT, we don't really know at this point how many we will have 5-10 years from now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Preben, for a very interesting talk. It's really interesting. And questions?
One question. You're talking mostly about single genes here, but it seems most likely as combinations of genes. So you ought to be able to see that by comparing the mutations in the population and the mutations in the families, and look for what are the really the combinations that make it a serious disease. That's one. And then the other one was on the fold of the four types of drugs. Is that based on the standard dosage, or is that standard a dosage in milligrams per kilogram or something? Or, I was a little puzzled on that, why you can't use the one that is less potent. Why can't you use three times as much?
Well, you can. I mean, I think that's what I'm saying. I think you can use any of these, even amiodarone, which was on the the bottom of the list, has been used in a patient who had recurrent shocks from his defibrillator because he went in, he would go into VF and VT all the time. So they loaded him amiodarone and it worked perfectly. So I fully agree, it's just that the effect on these mutated cells is not the same as on the wild type, the normal cell.
In terms of milligrams per dose?
Yeah, right.
And then on the multiple genes, it seems like that you should be able to find out a lot by just looking for the mutation frequency in the general population versus in other members of the families.
Most of the mutations here, they have looked at normal populations and not found any. So I mean, that's one of the ways to tell that this mutation probably is related to the disease, that it was not present in 20,000 other normal individuals. And then when they start to find more, some of them, as you see, is only one person. And the reason is often that families don't want to be tested. They say, no, we won't have anything, we don't want to know anything about that, we don't want anything to do with that. So very often they're lost there. They only have this one patient that came in with, was resuscitated from cardiac arrest, and he was the only one they had an opportunity to test because the rest of the family wouldn't let him do it. But that is one of the problems. I have a family up in Tennessee, and that's really the problem there until the other day when another member died suddenly. So now they're more, they're coming, but that's what it took. There was one 24-year-old girl that had died, and now a male in the family in his 40s died suddenly. So, but it takes something like that to really make people come and get tested. Because you're right, it would be nice to have more people in these families. And the unique thing in that family is actually it's Charles and Selvis' lab, also who's testing. They found two different mutations in that family. And the interesting thing is that some of these family members actually have a very long PR interval. They're first degree AV block and short QT. Some of them, others are only the short QT. So it's obviously the more you look at these mutations, the more mixed it becomes because you can get different phenotypes. You don't get exactly the same from the same mutation in everybody. And there's obviously a lot more to learn about this syndrome, but it's been a very interesting thing to follow from this one single EKD until. I think the reason there has been such an interest about this, despite the fact that so few patients, is because of the fact it's the opposite of the long QT. Everybody has thought that that's really interesting, that all of a sudden the short QT interval is just as important as the long QT. Yeah.
Are these patients responsive for beta blockers?
Beta blockers have not been tried in any of them. I don't know if they would work. The problem with any type of medication is obvious that there are so few patients and it's difficult to get enough material to really show that it works. So what they've been doing, those who have used pharmacologic treatment, is to simply look at prolongation of the QT and take this as a good thing. Whether it is or not, I don't know. It may not be, but that may, obviously a defibrillator is the treatment of choice. But again, it's different. This child I showed, the first patient now has a baby that's followed here at Barnes Hospital. And I think she has been started on disopyramide. That had turned out in testings in the lab to have a good profile. It looks like it's a good drug. But it does not prolong the QT, so you just have to give it and then hope it's going to do the trick. But that's the same for propafenone, which I used in my patients with atrial fibrillation, and it worked tremendous. It did not prolong the QT interval. So pharmacologic treatment is very difficult. And the thing is, you you only get one chance. I mean, this child dies, you know, you so as soon as they can get a defibrillator, they really should have one.
I have one question. How often are these patients combined with atrial fibrillation?
In the whole group of patients, about 15% have atrial fibrillation. Especially the HERC, H588K mutation. My patients, all four of them, at some point or another had atrial fibrillation. And that's the same for other of these, the same mutation. They have a very high likelihood of atrial fibrillation. But for the whole group, I think it was 15% that has atrial fibrillation. There's a KCNQ1 mutation that's reported in the familial form of atrial fibrillation. But again, it's a different mutation, but it's in the same gene. So, but they're very close to each other, so these two mutations. So, so there's no doubt that atrial fibrillation obviously is due to this short QT.
I think the mutation you mentioned about is for familial atrial fibrillation is S140G.
That's right. It's a Chinese family. That's right.
They didn't mention about the short QT.
Well, they found that the QT interval is normal. Well, that's what they reported. They reported it was normal. But you're right. I mean, it would be nice to see if maybe it is, because maybe they were not totally aware of the fact that it's not so easy to measure QT, especially in atrial fibrillation.
This mutation is just next to the
That's right. That's exactly right. These two mutations are right next to each other. So
the kinetics of the mutated IKS current.